All right, so today I want to talk about a proposed animal ban here in Colorado in the United States that includes snakes and other reptiles. And as a matter of fact, it's kind of a blanket over all exotic animals. And this one I actually heard about through word of mouth. I didn't actually hear about it first on the internet or social media. That is usually where I hear about it first. As a matter of fact, I went over to the US ARC main page, the usarc.org website, and they didn't have anything on it yet. It is brand new. But I actually found out that US ARC has a Facebook page. Didn't even know they had a Facebook page, and they had it right in the top, in the front headlines on their Facebook page. They give a lot of information about it, and I kind of want to cover that today. And the interesting thing is, being a reptile breeder like I am here in my basement, I breed ball pythons and some reticulated pythons. Really, the reticulated pythons, really, you have to stay on top of that, especially with the regulations. They actually, you know, included in the Lacey Act a few years ago, where you couldn't ship reticulated pythons across state lines. So can you imagine if you're actually breeding retics and you had all these hatchlings and you really didn't know what to do with them and you couldn't ship them out? You could only sell them within, you know, the state that you're living in. That would be devastating for a breeder. Luckily, I'm just kind of dabbling in reticulated pythons, and my main focus is ball pythons. I haven't really seen a lot of restrictions on keeping and breeding ball pythons as far as Colorado. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to jump over to the internet and I want to show you some of the details of this proposed animal ban. All right, so I'm over here at usarc.org, and this is the homepage for USARC. It's a nonprofit organization that fights for your right to keep exotic animals, including snakes and other reptiles. And the homepage here, you can look at all these different bullet points. These are all the kind of the hot things that are going on in the reptile industry. They focus mainly on reptiles and other exotic animals. And the things that are at the very top of the page, especially if they're in red, they're kind of the hot topics that are the newest on the scene here, in especially in the ball python industry. And I would say I probably don't come over here enough. A lot of times I'll check it like every couple weeks and it's like, oh, there's something like 2 weeks old that I probably should have been on top of right when it came out. And you can actually donate to USARC. I'm not really affiliated with USARC. As a matter of fact, when I ship out a snake like a ball python, I just started shipping, I go over to shipyourreptiles.com, and it has all these little check boxes. And one of the checkboxes that is automatically checked when I ship a snake is that it donates $1 to USARC every time I ship a snake. That's pretty cool. You can actually donate more over here. It's kind of an interesting program. I'd say this is probably the only thing that I really know of that really fights for your rights to keep a lot of the animals. And if you just kind of scroll down through here, you see there's a lot of things in red. Those are the hot topics. And I'd say most of them are really specific to different states. So for example, this one's in Pennsylvania, Utah, and Missouri, West Virginia, and some of them are proposing complete animal bans all across the state. And you know, a lot of those don't pass. A lot of them are just so outrageous, you can't keep any pets at all. You know, if they actually passed that, then they had to close down all the pet stores, everyone had to get rid of their pets. That would really decimate the economy, because you know, a lot of people are fighting, you know, to keep these as pets. It's kind of interesting. There's a whole kind of a subculture that a lot of people aren't aware of when they buy a snake, and a lot of people are fighting for your rights behind the scenes so you can actually keep that snake. It's kind of interesting. So I actually was kind of surprised, you know, I actually heard that, you know, people are talking about, you know, the proposed animal ban in Colorado. I came over here and I'm like, it's not on the top of the list, what's going on? And then I did a search on Google and found out that USARC actually has a Facebook page. And this is kind of I clicked on their ad and it kind of expanded. This is the alert in Colorado. This is kind of the first time I've ever seen one targeted to Colorado. You know, they're just kind of random all over different states. And of course, I live in Colorado, so it's really a big deal. And if you come over here to Facebook, this is actually the USARC Facebook page. As a matter of fact, you might be wondering if I actually have a Facebook account. I actually did make a Facebook account, but I don't really do anything on Facebook. I'm mainly focused on YouTube. And kind of the bummer about Facebook is that you really can't see anybody's pages unless you actually sign up for a Facebook account. It's not like YouTube, where you can actually just kind of scroll through their videos and watch a video without actually having an account over on YouTube. So this is kind of interesting. If you kind of scroll down a little bit, you can see this is like the number one thing. It's the most recent story here. As a matter of fact, if you look down here, it was posted 23 hours ago, pretty fresh off of the press here in Colorado. And actually, I came down here and I hit continue reading, and I expanded the story. And when you expand it, you can actually see all the details and the action items and everything you can do down here. And I just kind of want to give you a highlight of what's going on as far as this exotic animal ban here in Colorado. So essentially what this is a ban on educational outreach programs and with any animal non-native to Colorado. It's the Senate Bill 20-125. And a lot of times what they'll actually do is they'll write this bill and they'll kind of target it at, for example, there's a lot of people against, you know, elephants in circuses. So what they'll do is they'll propose this bill and it'll kind of target that. But the problem is a lot of these aren't written very well. They're not very specific and they have a lot of unintended consequences. So you can actually read through the lines on a lot of these and kind of pull out some of the unintended consequences. As a matter of fact, it has a little paragraph down here. So as it is written here in this bill, it says here on the USR website here, it says the unintended consequences are many. It is a ban on taking a Greek tortoise into a classroom for educational program and reptiles. It is a ban on taking a ball python, a red-eyed tree frog, a parakeet, a hedgehog into a library or a scout troop meeting or an educational show discussing the differences between reptiles, amphibians, birds, and mammals. So you can see they kind of read through the lines and they say, hey, the way this is written, you know, it's not really written properly. It's not really a narrow focus. There's a lot of problems with the way this is actually written. We definitely don't want this to pass. You know, there's some people that is all they do. I've actually seen some people, well, they'll have like 10 or 15 reptiles, and for a living, they'll go from school to school doing presentations on their snakes and their tortoises and like that. It's a really fulfilling job, I would say, you know, working with the kids and showing them. Some of these kids have never seen any of these reptiles. You know, I've actually seen a lot of videos of people actually teaching the kids. It's pretty awesome going into classrooms. And this, the way it's written, it would actually ban it. And the interesting thing is, you know, I'm actually against this. So I can actually do an action item. Even though I don't take reptiles into classrooms, I don't want this to hurt the reptile community. So if you actually scroll all the way down there, you can read all the details. You can actually come over here and read it. At the very bottom, it has some action items. So a lot of times over here on USARC, it's really probably the best thing about USARC is they give you exactly what you can do. And it just kind of calls them out here. Number one, you can call the officials. Number two, you can email the officials. Number three, you can fax letters. Number four, you can attend hearings and voice opposition if possible. So here in Colorado, I can actually travel to some of these meetings and express my concern over this. And then a lot of times what they'll do is they'll actually give you a letter that you can write. So for example, this is, you know, an email, and they give you the subject line, they give you all the details and all the wording and everything. And a lot of times they'll give you like five or six examples of a letter that you can compose, either email it or fax it or send it through the mail to the certain people. A lot of times they'll give you the names and addresses and even the phone numbers of a lot of these officials. It's pretty powerful over here on USARC. The other thing is they give you a link over here to kind of the official documents, and this is actually the Colorado General Assembly, and you can actually click on the PDF, then you can open up the PDF and it gives you everything, you know, kind of the legal terminology for exactly what they're talking about in the actual bill, so you can actually read it for yourself. And the thing that really concerns me is if you actually go against this and decide, all right, I'm going to take my snakes and I'm going to go into the classroom, even if this passes, and a lot of times if this passes as law and you go into the classroom and you don't know about it, they actually call out the fine. The fine is between $250 and $1,000 per violation. So you take your ball python, you go into a classroom, you talk about your ball python, I might bring Bobby or something like that. It could be $1,000 fine if this actually passes and I don't know about it and I take my snake into a classroom. All right, so it is time for the question of the day. And Colin Willard asks, is Bobby anything other than bamboo? Are there any other genes in the mix? And that is a very good question. The snake that I have around my neck, this is Bobby. And he is just a straight bamboo, no recessives, no other genes in the mix. Pretty awesome. And I'd say bamboo is definitely probably my number one favorite morph as far as just a standalone morph. I'd say there are other morphs that maybe work a little bit better when they're combined with other stuff, but I say as far as just a standalone morph, you really can't beat the bamboo. It looks really close to a spider, except there's no neurological issues with the bamboo. No kinking, no duck bills, or any kind of a genetic anomaly that I've seen with the bamboo with any other combo, which is pretty awesome. And I'd say as far as a standalone morph, it looks pretty close to a spider. It almost looks like it has some calico in it, maybe some spider. It looks like multiple genes all together. It's pretty impressive. It's actually just one gene. You actually breed this to even a normal classic wild type ball python. Half the babies come out looking like this. Pretty awesome morph. And the thing that I really like about it is, I don't know if you can see it on camera, but if you look really close, it almost looks metallic. You can get some really awesome metallic looking snakes when you breed it, especially if you breed it with pinstripe, or I actually have a bamboo lemon blast, bamboo pastel pinstripe. That thing almost looks like it's made of metal, especially when they're young hatchlings. Pretty awesome. So that is pretty much it. Thanks for watching, and I will see you in the next video.